Today I will be mixing glazes. If you know how to follow a simple recipe for food or something, you will be able to make your own glazes. And not only is it great fun to do your own glazes, you can also get glazes that you can't buy commercially. And what I like, it's much cheaper. So let's get on with it. I put all my glazes into this spreadsheet. So for each glaze, I have a tab. And the one we're gonna mix today is called Lynette's Opal. It's a very beautiful, subtle blue with some breaking of purple and light. It's a very nice cone 6 glaze. And what I also done is that I put all my materials, all the stuff that I need to buy or have bought, and the suppliers and the price and the amounts that they come in. So that way I can automatically generate a price list as well. And as you see, this is so what I do is here I add the percentages for the main ingredients and then the additives. And I automatically calculate, so you don't make any mistakes, how much to put in. In this case, I'm gonna mix 5,000 grams, so 5 kilo. And then you can see exactly how much that equals to. That makes it much easier. And also, based on my material list, I calculate the pricing. And as you can see here, the total cost of this particular glaze, 5 kilo, is 123 Danish kroner. What is that? That is maybe $20 or something. So that's dirt cheap compared to what you would pay for a commercial glaze. It's, I don't know, a fifth or a tenth of it. And then, of course, by mixing it yourself, you can also make small adjustments. So let's get on with it. Let's go and take a look at the materials and what we need to do the glazing or the glaze mix. Okay, so now we're ready. So let's get on and go and pick the materials that we need and the or the tools that we need to mix the glaze. I store most of my materials in this outside shed. It's dry, so they won't be humid or anything, but it is cold in the winter, but it doesn't matter. Most of it is just stone and different minerals, and that survives fine, even if it's very cold. Of course, everything that's liquid, I store inside. So I collected all these materials over time. You'll probably find that you won't be able to get all the materials you want from one supplier. Even the big ones don't have everything. So I bought it from 2 or 3 different suppliers here in Europe, where I live. You do need some amount of materials before you can start mixing. Most of the glazes only have 3, 4, 5, 6 different materials, but it's basically lots of the same materials that go through the different glazes. Of course, you have some materials you only use in some glazes and in others, but if you collect these basic, I would say maybe 20, 30 different materials, you actually have everything it takes to do most glazes. For example, this glaze we're doing today, Lynette's Opal, was just something that I saw recently a potter use, and I really like the outcome. So I got the recipe and I went home and I realized that I have everything for it. So that's the 9th thing about building up this this collection of materials. Now I have all the materials collected. This recipe is actually a little more complex than most recipes, so there's 10 different ingredients. But let's take a look at the other things that you need to mix your glazes. Of course, you need some bucket to mix a glaze in. I use these 10-liter buckets because with 5 kilo of dry ingredients and the water, it fills up to about here something, which is perfect for my use. I do also have some bigger buckets, like this one down here, for clear glazes that are dip a lot in. So I have that. And then of course we have all the materials. Of course you need a scale. I like these digital scales because what I can do is I can put my bucket to put in the material and I can reset it and then it goes to 0. So now I can measure whatever materials correctly. I also have a bigger bucket, of course, because some materials you need a lot of. And then you need this one. And you may wonder, what is that? Well, this is something I use to measure specific gravity. So when we are mixing glazes, we want to make sure that the relationship between dry materials and water is exactly right. That is not the same for all glazes. For this particular glaze, I know from other potters that a specific gravity of 1.42 will be good. So you can use any type of glass tube or anything like this to do it. So what you do basically is that you put it on your scale, reset it, and then you fill it up with water until you reach 100 gram. I already done that, and then I marked it with tape. So then when I have to measure my glaze, I put it up to the edge of the tape, and then I read how much it weighed. And if it's 142 grams, then it's a specific gravity of 1.42, which is what I'm aiming for. So if it's too high, I need to put in more water, because the dry materials are more heavy than the water. We'll get back to that after I mix the glaze. So, last thing, I almost forgot that, you need protection. I have this really good mask. That takes all kinds of chemicals and dust and acid gases and stuff. I also use it for raku and pit fire. But this is sufficient for this as well. Because basically always when we work with dusty things, clay or whatever, you need to protect your lungs. But with these materials, you need it even more. These materials I use for this glaze is not too bad, but sometimes you use oxides and copper and cobalt and stuff that is definitely not good to get into your lungs. But anyway, protect yourself, that is important. So mixing the glazes, I will wear that, so I'll probably not talk too much. And if I do, you won't understand what I say. Oh yeah, I forgot one other thing. I like these little metal shovels. You can also use plastic spoon or whatever. I just like these ones because they're very nice and easy to use. When you mix your glazes, one of the mistakes you can make, and I did that on a few occasions, is that you forget an ingredient or you add one ingredient two times, and then of course the glaze turns totally different. Sometimes good, most often not. So it's very important that you mark whenever you put it in. That's why I put all the ingredients on the table, and whenever I'm done with one, I'm gonna put it on the floor, and also I'm gonna mark it in my spreadsheet. So I'm double securing myself, because I don't wanna make that mistake. So now I will start, and the first ingredients is nepheline cyanide. I'm not sure how to pronounce that correctly, but I hope you get it anyway. So on with the mask. And that is the main ingredients in this recipe. So we need 1,900 grams of that. And then I'll put it in my bucket. And this is where it gets dusty. That's why you wear the mask. And now you probably can't hear what I'm saying. But anyway. Put it on the floor, mark it in my spreadsheet, and now it's time to move on to the next, which is silica or quartz, and we need 250 grams of that. So, the next thing is whitening. And we only need 350 grams of that. And then we need olesonite. And we need 100 grams. And then we need some EPK or kaolin. That's only 8%, so 400 grams. And we need a little bit of talc. I just get this from a drugstore, not from a potter supply. My local potter supply don't even have it because it's so dirt cheap in a normal store, or even in a supermarket they sometimes have it. And we only need 250 grams for that. And we need 500 grams of Gerstner borate. And this, the Gerstner borate has been widely discussed because the mine where it comes from is actually closed. But there's so much of it on the market and a lot of suppliers have bought tons of it. If you are very afraid of running out of Gerstner borate, you should probably buy up some stock of it. I'm not too afraid. The suppliers that I buy from, they say they have enough for years. So I'm not too afraid, but I still have, I don't know, 20 or something laying around. Anyway, we need 500 grams for that. So that was all the main ingredients. Typically for most recipes, you have a set of main ingredients that runs up to 100%. And then you have some additives. And in this case, we're gonna have some bentonite and rutile. So let's start out with the rutile. It's 8%, so 400 grams. One thing you will notice when you are mixing materials is how much different it is in the weight. And it's important to remember that for most recipes, it's based on weight. So the percentages are weight. There are a few recipes, like I use a one layer slip for naked ragu, and that is by volume. So you have to make sure that when you do a recipe, whether it's by volume or by weight, because there's a huge difference. I don't know if you noticed the rutile, I just put in there is very heavy. So 400 grams of that actually take up less than half the space of 400 grams of some of the other ingredients. So you have to be very careful for that. So the last thing we need now is the bentonite, and it's only 2%, so 100 grams. So that's it. Now I mix the glaze, more or less. We still need to add water and we need to sieve it. But let's just add the water first and then we can talk about what we do next. Lots of people have asked me, how much water do I need to add to my glaze? And to be honest, I don't know. It depends on the glaze and it depends on the specific gravity that you are looking for. And yeah, so there's so many variables. But don't worry too much about that, because what we're doing now is just dissolving it. So we just need to put some water in there. And be sure that you put too little water. It's much easier to add more water later than it is to take it out, of course. So today we're just gonna add this water, we're gonna stir it a little bit, and then we're gonna let it sit overnight. Because what happens is that all these dry materials, it takes a little bit time for them to dissolve. And so by leaving it for tomorrow and then mixing it up again and then sieving it, that will secure that you get a glaze without bubbles, without any lumps or anything that will work well for you. So let's just add some water to it now. It's the next day. My glaze have, I'm just gonna put it up here, my glaze have matured for 24 hours, or just about that. And it has settled a little more, so I can now see that most of the dry materials have absorbed into the water, which is exactly what I wanted. So now I'm ready to sieve it, because we need to get, there's still, it's maybe hard to see there, but there's still some lumps in it. There will always be before you sieve it. And we need to adjust it so that we get the correct specific gravity for this glaze, which for this glaze is 1.42. So I need my weight, and I need my glass that have been adjusted to 100 milliliters of water being 100 grams. So that works. And so now we need to sieve it. Before I do that, I'll just show you this sieve. This is a cheap one. It's there are all kinds of sieves. What is important is the mesh size. This is a 60 mesh. Usually you would sieve a glaze between 60 and 80 mesh. This one seems to work fine. The mesh size is a question of how big the holes in the mesh is. So the higher the number, the smaller the size. So 60 is a moderately small one. It works fine for me, at least. So I'm going to pour the glaze into it. And just hold on a second, because what I'm going to do to get it through is maybe different than what you think. To push the glaze through the mesh, or the sieve, I use this brush. I turn out to be much better than any other tool, because then you can just work it there, and then you get all the little lumps massaged into it. So, let's see how that goes. It probably won't fit all of it at one go, but I'll just try and push some of it there. I'm never going to use this, just in circles. And as you can hear, it's going through, so that's perfect. And as you can see, there's some lumps left here. We'll try and see if we can get most of it through, because that's dry material. There's always going to be a little bit left. It's okay. Oh, I think we can have it. My glaze have been sieved, and there shouldn't be any lumps left in this bucket. So now we are ready to measure the specific gravity. Hopefully it's a little too high, so I can thin it out. If it's too low, then I need to let it sit for some time for the water to evaporate. But I think I'm good with this one. So you put the glass on the weight and reset it. So it counts to zero. And then you fill up the glass until it reaches the measurement that you set. It feels like there's still a few lumps in here, so maybe I will have to sieve it one more time. Sometimes you need to do that after I adjust it. So let's see how it is. And as you can see, hopefully you can see it, it's 152, which is good because that means that it's still a little too thick. It's too heavy. There's too much of the dry material compared to the water. So we'll need to add some more water, but that's perfect. So we put it back. Remember to completely empty it, so you're not left with now that we need to add more water, we can clean it at the same time. Back here. So how much more water? I don't know, but I have to try. Just add a little bit more and see how it goes. So let's try again and see how that goes. So now, after a few more adjustments, it now weighs exactly, let me see if you can see it here, exactly 142 grams, which equals a specific gravity of 1.42. So that is perfect for this particular glaze, the Lunette's Opal, at least in the application that I'm going to use. So now I'm more or less ready to glaze my things. I will, as I mentioned, I've felt like there was still a few lumps in here, so I'll clean up my bucket and my sieve, and I will sieve it one more time back in the original bucket, and then I'm ready to glaze. I glazed some pots, some bowls, and a couple of vases with this new glaze, the Lunette's Opal, and I fired them over the last 24 hours and it's cooled down. This is now morning and it's about 60 degrees or something, so you can barely touch it, but it's okay. So now is an interesting part of looking at the results. I already removed the top layer because there were some bowls that had nothing to do with this particular glaze test, and there's some of these vases that are with other glazes. This is one of my all-time favorite glazes, a floating blue in a sort of a modified version, but this comes out really, really nice. So let's put that aside. So here we have the first impression of Lunette's Opal, and I kind of like it. It's not as blue as I was expecting. I think when it's applied a little thicker, it turns a little whiter, and then where it's thinner, it's a little more blue. And then you have these subtle red blushes or rosa or something. It looks really nice. My daughter loves it. So I think that turned out okay. The second one is also not too bad. It's sort of have a little bit of that uribe feel that you get from a wood fire, which is a very nice quality, and the patterns, of course, they come up very strong. Again, not quite as blue as I was expecting, but on this one, there's a lot of red, or rosa, I would say, which emphasize the structure, and I really like that. Also some brownish there. I don't know how that came. It's always sort of a mystery, but definitely a good result. It is, now that I see it in light, a little more bluish, greenish than it looked down there, but that's fine. And as always, when I fire, especially when I fire new glazes, I put in some test cones. This one is my floating blue. I already know how that looks, but I didn't have a test cone. I made these ones. I can show you one day how I make them, very easy. And I make a hole so I can put them on a wall. And this one is with another glaze favorite of mine called Waterfall. and it really breaks very beautiful. I have this greenish color that I like. So that one goes on the wall too. And here's my Linette Opal. This is just with one layer. And here I double dipped it on the top. It doesn't actually look so much different, but it breaks beautifully. So definitely I have these to go on my wall. I have to be careful here because, yeah. And this one is sort of interesting too. This is a glaze that I just tested from Terracolor. Terracolor makes some nice commercial glazes, and they can be quite expensive, but I found a place in Germany called BSZ. They don't actually advertise them as Terracolors, but it is. I talked to them, and that makes it much cheaper. And this one actually turned out really interesting. Very, very vivid color. So, I'm happy about that one too. Let's put it over here. And this is the last one. This one is a floating blue. No, not floating blue. The waterfall. I applied some copper carbonate here in the cracks, and the copper carbonate is tricky because if you apply it too thick, it just turns black. If it's too light, then well, doesn't give any color. But this actually turned out really nice. So now I'm ready to remove the last layer, and below here is all the bowls that I did with Linette's Opal. So now the last layer with my bowls, and again they didn't turn out as blue as I expected, but still they're not bad, and it is sort of a very light blue, and the application is beautiful. It breaks nice, and again there's some subtle rosa colors to it, so these are definitely not bad. I will show you some studio pictures of these bowls and vases in the end of the video. Thank you for now. I hope you enjoyed it and find inspiration in creating your own glazes. If you do, I highly recommend a website called glazy.org. I will put a link in the description. There are tons of glazes and calculators and all kinds of things you can use when you are working with glazes, working with mixing your own glazes. So please remember to subscribe and like and share this post, then you will be updated about other videos. I have a few more videos coming up this month, one about reclaiming clay and one about my project about building a gas-fired kiln. So please stay tuned, and I hope to see you soon again.